Yeah, technically we covered now everything I wanted to cover about k-fold cross-validation and model selection. However, then I realized there's one more topic I wanted to cover. That's the one standard error method. So it's more like related to the fact that we have seen in the last coding example, where we sometimes find that multiple hyperparameter settings perform very similar or even completely identically well. So which one should we choose? In scikit-learn, it always chooses the first one in the list, right? If we have a tie, if there are two settings that perform equally well. But there's another method of tie breaking. So it goes back to the law of parsimony, or which some people call Occam's razor, which says among competing hypotheses, the one with the fewest assumptions should be selected. So you can consider it as a tiebreaker if you find that two hyperparameter settings perform equally well. I would suggest to prefer the one with a fewer assumptions or the simpler one. So I will also show you an example what I mean by simple. So I also found a quote in an article by Pedro Domingos. The article is called 10 Myths About Machine Learning. So in this article, Pedro Domingos writes that simpler models are more accurate. This belief is sometimes equated with Occam's razor, but the razor only says that simpler explanations are preferable, not why. So he was just explaining there's a misconception that some people think that simpler models could be more accurate. This is not necessarily true. It's unrelated to Occam's razor. What Occam's razor says is if two models perform equally well, the simpler one is preferable. It also doesn't say why, though. Okay, so he says they are preferable because they are easier to understand, remember, and reason with, which is something I agree with. So a simpler model is usually easier to explain. So easier to explain its behavior. I will also show you an example of what I mean by that. And sometimes the simplest hypothesis consistent with the data is less accurate for prediction than a more complicated one. Some of the most powerful learning algorithms output models that seem gradually elaborate, sometimes even continuing to add them to them after they have perfectly fit the data, but that's how they beat the less powerful ones. So usually, the more complicated the model, the better it may perform, especially during evaluation, because there can be some slight overfitting effects, even if we use cross-validation techniques. So if we find that two models perform equally well within a margin, I would go for the simpler one. He also further says that, however, if two models perform equally well, the simpler one seems more likely, among other advantages. I'm not completely sure what he means by more likely. Maybe he refers to explaining some natural phenomenon, but I don't think any of the machine learning models are kind of related to some natural effect. But it's more like we are approximating a function. Maybe the function is closer to the true function if it's the simpler one. But I would say this one, I don't know if there's evidence for that. However, I find selecting a simpler model has really the advantages, like he said earlier, that it's easier to understand, remember, and reason with. It's easier to analyze also, and sometimes it's even computationally cheaper. So usually using a simpler model is preferable, especially if you have two models anyways that give you almost the same performance. Why not going for the simpler one? So now the one standard error method. So consider the numerically optimal estimate and its standard error. So if you do the model selection, you get via k-fold cross-validation the performance estimates. You find that sometimes two hyperparameter settings give you a very similar or identical performance. Then you can select the model whose performance is within one standard error of the value obtained in step one. You have, let's say, an optimal method that has the absolute best performance, and you just look which of the other settings are within one standard error of this performance. I will also show you a code example how I would do that in practice, so that's also then more clear. The code example will be in the next lecture. I couldn't find a paper for that method, actually. It's something I would personally use. I think I remember having seen that somewhere. But I honestly don't know if there's a publication on that. Otherwise, I would be happy to share the paper with you. If you finds a paper that refers to this method or a similar method, I would also be happy to know, because then I can include it in the links. So right now this would be more something I would recommend. I don't know if someone has more deeply studied that. Anyways, so consider a data set, some toy data set I generated with scikit-learn, where we have two classes. So that's a binary classification data set. We have these squares here as class, let's say class 1, and the triangles as class 2. And yeah, the task is to classify squares and triangles. So we are going to consider an RBF kernel SVM now. I realize we haven't talked about RBF kernel SVMs in this class, but it's just simpler to illustrate this method in the context of a kernel SVM because, yeah, it's more obvious to show you what a simpler and a more complex model is. So RBF kernel SVM. Actually, I could maybe also do this example with a k-nearest neighbor method. Maybe we can observe something similar when we vary the number of k. That might be a good exercise to do at home or maybe even homework. So, but now back to this kernel SVM, which I just happened to choose here. So we have a gamma parameter, which is a scaling parameter of how much influence each training example has. So a kernel SVM was a once very popular method, like in the 2000s, because it got a really good performance. It's a method where you start basically with a model that is a linear model, like very similar to logistic regression. We have a decision boundary. It's actually a constraint optimization problem where you maximize the distance between each training examples and the decision boundary. But then there is some concept called the kernel trick, where you implicitly compute the similarity of the examples. So you implicitly project them to an infinite dimensional space and then get a decision boundary there and then project it back. It sounds very complicated, but in practice it's actually not too complicated to implement. It relies on a so-called kernel matrix, which is just a pairwise distance matrix. And yeah, because it's a pairwise distance matrix, it's also not a great algorithm for large data sets, because if you have, let's say, 100,000 examples, you will have a 100,000 times 100,000 matrix, which kind of exceeds the computer memory. I'm just thinking of this example because there was one student in the office hours yesterday. We were talking about SVMs. So yeah, this is why we also kind of have an SVM example here. In any case, so we have now here this gamma parameter, but you can also do this experiment with a k-nearest neighbor model. And now we have for this hyperparameter, when we tune this hyperparameter, we find that there are multiple accuracies here from 60% up to 90%. Some of them are very similar. If we make gamma too large, the performance will decline. If we make gamma too small, the performance will also be low. So this is somewhat, you will see in the next slides, this is somewhat related to overfitting here. And this is more like underfitting. So high bias here. And here we have high variance. And this might be a range here where we are doing quite well. But now we have these also these 3 points. So which one would we select? So here I have plotted the decision boundaries for different classifiers. I actually, I don't know if this is, I probably picked this one, but I could have also equally picked this one. Maybe it was easier to illustrate here. So this is 0.001, so it's 10 to the power of minus 3. Maybe I made a typo, I have to double check, and meant 10 minus 2, but in either case, I picked a simple model for this one, and for this one I picked the simplest model from this range. So this is actually this one, this is 10 to the minus 1, 0.1. And here I have 10, so this would be this one. Let's use maybe a different color. So we have these three different colors. And you can see, based on the decision boundary, how complex the model is. So of course, you can't really do that if you have a data set with more than two features, because then you can't draw a decision boundary. But you can think of it like that, that the more we go to the right, this would be high complexity. And here on the left hand side, we would have low complexity. So the larger gamma is the more complicated the model, because the more each training example will influence each other or the other training examples. So you can see here the decision boundary is way more complicated than this one, which is almost a linear decision boundary. So this one here on the left-hand side is simpler than the one on the right-hand side. And here this at point one, which is this one here, this seems to be the simplest one. So this one is much simpler than this one. However, the performance, now I was drawing so much that we can't barely see that, but the performance is within one standard error. So the performance is actually almost the same, identical, within one standard error. However, the model is much simpler. You can see this is just quadratic here. So it's just a circle. So you can see this is a simple decision boundary, and it's kind of also simpler to understand this decision boundary than a more complicated one. So I can, based on, if I know that this is a circle here or ellipse, and a kind of squished circle, I can kind of understand if a data point falls outside the circle, you can express as a simple function the decision boundary. You can tell someone it's within or without because it was too large or too small on one axis. Here on the right hand side it would be a little bit more complicated because you have like this more complicated decision surface. So here the one standard error method would be the one selecting the smallest gamma within the best performing one. For example, assume this one is the best performing one. I would just check all of them which has the which is in one standard error, and then picking the simplest one. And the simplest one would be the one to the left, because it's the smallest gamma. It's within one standard error of the best one, so we can actually select this model. And yeah, you can maybe also try to repeat this analysis with k and k nearest neighbors. So here in k nearest neighbors, it would be the other way around. Model with low value of k, with the smallest value, let's say k equals 1, would be the most complicated one, most complex one, because the decision boundary would be most complicated. And the highest k would be low complexity, because that would create the simplest decision boundary. Okay, so in the next video I will show you a code example how we can implement the one standard error method in practice.